going down. I'm yelling timber, you better move, you better dance.
So we, as Gabe said, had quite an esteemed group of folks here, and I'm going to ask each of you to introduce yourselves, but perhaps even more importantly, because I think everybody knows who they are, what is their role today related to the Upfronts?
Carl? Hi, I'm Carl Fremont. I'm the Global Chief Digital Officer at MEC, and I also lead some of our large global clients. And for me, the Upfront is about how we're going to integrate all the video together across device and across platform. So it's no longer kind of a single Upfront. It's looking at all of this together.
Thank you. Denise?
Hi, I'm Denise Colella. I'm the SVP of Advanced Advertising Products and Strategy at NBC Universal. We run the Audience Studio, which plays very heavily into our Upfront offerings, and we make sure that we're helping our clients achieve the greatest ROI by using our data products.
Hi, I'm Peter Naylor. I run advertising sales at Hulu, so I run our Upfront from a pricing and product perspective, leading our team into that. And I think our biggest job is to help people understand how Hulu can complement and fit into the Upfront mix for people like Carl.
Thank you. Erica?
Hi, I'm Erica Schmidt. I'm the managing director of Cadreon North America. Cadreon is part of Media Brands and sister business to Magna, when you just saw David Cohen. My role in the Upfronts is really to feed into the work that Magna does on behalf of all of the Media Brands agencies, specifically on the advanced TV front, which we've been pioneering in for several years now and starting to see some real material coverage in the Upfronts for us to be able to look at the inventory the way that we would like to. And feeding in and thinking about how we manage that into a cross-screen environment.
Great, thank you. Jason?
Good morning. Jason DeMarco, VP Programmatic and Audience Solutions at A&E Networks. Role in the Upfront is really looking at advanced targeting in a cross-channel manner, especially now as we move into this next year where I think it becomes a little bit more of an ask from the agency side.
Great, thank you. So, the Upfronts. I'm not sure how many of you are aware of the complexities that occur during that time window. So the official start date is March 2nd. I believe Nickelodeon is kickstarting, and it finishes up around May 18th with NBC Cable, I think, is one of the last to present. There will be 65 separate meetings from different media outlets, 65 unique media outlets, occurring across 30 business days in 8 cities. So you can imagine that, just the orchestration of that many events and the scale and the complexities around them. And so first I'd like to ask Carl and Erica, first, God bless you for listening to those and attending those. How do you navigate through them?
The way we really navigate through them is to kind of prioritize. So looking at, because it's impossible to attend every solitary one. So we make sure that they're all covered by all of our team that's in the market and come together before, during, and after to kind of review what's going on and our positioning in the market. But it's impossible to go to for any one person to go to every one. So you're really looking at where are you prioritizing, what are the must-attend ones, and how do we cover it across all of the agency.
Because that's the expectations
Correct.
Of your clients. They want that footprint. Erica, similarly?
A pretty similar answer. I think the benefit that we have is the power of Magna. And really it's about how making sure that we do have coverage everywhere, but prioritizing that. But we have folks like Brian Hughes who share coverage of what's gone on in each Upfront in detail and giving a point of view on that, which makes it a lot easier for us to navigate it rather than if I attended every single Upfront, I wouldn't get anything else done or be able to work on behalf of clients like Hulu, for example. So really it's about that prior, I know, I had to give a shout out.
Nicely done.
It's all about that prioritization really that I think is important and the networks and the Upfronts that we're putting the biggest bets on.
Thank you. So then on the converse side, you have to imagine if you're a media outlet, how do you differentiate yourself from everybody else so that as an agency or on behalf of their clients, there's that aha moment or off-course moment. Denise, what happens at NBC to differentiate yourselves?
Sure, I think we differentiate by bringing all of our great premium content together into the single Upfront, right? But then also augmenting that with our data products and making sure we're really focusing on the marriage of the data and then the premium content.
Okay. Peter?
Yeah, you know, at Hulu, it's a constant sales opportunity to remind people who we are, because who we are keeps changing all the time. For example, you might not know it, but 75% of the viewing of Hulu content happens in a living room environment. Now, in a world where everyone's saying mobile first, mobile first, mobile first, we're kind of a living room first environment. So living room is growing, and it's up to 75% of the viewing, while desktop has contracted to just 9% of the viewing. Now, mobile tablet is growing, but it's not growing as fast as living room. So we reiterate our unique position in the market, and we try to go big. You know, we go to MSG, and we invite the entire community, and we bring out our star power. So we try and differentiate based on the product, and then it's show business. So put on a big show.
Thank you. Jason, what do you guys do at A&E?
I think for A&E Networks, the long history of great content continues to bring people. But now we're, as the entire marketplace starts to change and evolve, we're starting to focus our efforts in other areas, like creative branding and content creation in conjunction with agencies and brands, and being able to offer our best services in conjunction with the data, with the content, and bringing it all together in a single platform, and being able to really act as subject matter experts or guiding, kind of the guiding light, if you will, to help partners through the what's becoming a clouded and gray space right now.
So if you think about the upfronts, it's almost like, I kind of equate it to and with all due respect, like a debutante party where, wow, this is a coming out, here's some new program, some great content. But it's not always just about this great content, right? It's about the data, the viewers, and the expectations on behalf of the clients of who's going to engage with that content and therefore correspond with the advertising. So, Denise, from the data side, I think there's pockets. There's data, which becomes information, which becomes intelligence. And with intelligence, then you can make good media decisions. How does NBC position themselves as it relates to the data overlaying on the great content that you produce?
Sure, data is really paramount to everything that we do. So we have some of the richest data sources in the industry, including the Comcast set-top box data that provides us with a wealth of information about what people are watching, when they're watching, and then it allows us to help our advertisers really reach those people at the right time adjacent to the right content. So we're able to do that on a various number of fronts, including whether you're trying to reach niche audiences, right, or whether you're trying to work with a program like This Is Us and going for mass reach. So the data is really advising everything we do on the front end to get the message to the right consumer, but then we're also looking at it on the back end so that we can make sure we're measuring it correctly and constantly optimizing the process.
How about you, Peter?
At the debutante ball, everybody does put out their best shows, but the shows are designed to attract the audience that the marketers want to buy. It's the audience that's the product, it's not the show. And in fact, we've always been selling the audience first, primarily because when Hulu was set up, we were forbidden from selling shows. People would only license us their shows if we didn't conspire against the sales forces who we licensed the content from. So as a best practice, we've always been selling people and audiences first. So the shows attract the subscribers, we sell the subscribers, and then when you salt and pepper data on top of it, everything becomes much more interesting. I mean, to echo Dave Cohen from earlier, he wants to go beyond age and demo, and the data allows us to do that. So he's willing to do it, we're enabled to do it. I don't know why that shouldn't be a bigger part of the conversation this year.
Yeah, and it may very well be. Basically, David made a great point about bringing all those industry titans together to make those decisions happen. I'm wondering, Jason, on your side, as it relates to data for A&E.
So being that we don't have a broadcast channel and we rely on our six major cable networks, we look at the data that we have available to us through different licensing partnerships across the national footprint, and then couple it with our digital offerings, which gets us the addressability option. And we look at them as collaborative pieces. Until addressability reaches the national TV landscape, we think that our best kind of approach is to continue to use that in an aggregated index way and use addressability in digital to kind of extend that reach and continue to drive the message to the right people, whether it's a retargeting message or just reaching those viewers that aren't actually viewing live linear but are consuming in OTT or across the mobile iPads, phones, etc.
So before we jump to the agency perspective in terms of, are you guys getting enough data? Is there new data that we should see or anticipate with the upfronts that we've never seen before, a new cut of the data or a new segmentation that will give us that wow factor?
I think there's new data all the time. It's a living, breathing thing. And I think as televisions get smarter and the feedback path gets richer, we'll always be looking at what new data is available to bring in. I think what we're seeing a lot more of over the past year or so, really, is the brands bringing their own data to the table. You know, 2 years ago, we were able to facilitate them bringing their own data, and they weren't quite ready. But over the past year, we've seen a huge increase of these brands saying, well, I want you to help me reach the people I know are my consumers, and we're able to do that for them.
And that's first-party data that you're seeing?
Exactly right.
Wow, that's great. So, Jason, did you have...
No, I want to kind of echo the same thing, that it's not necessarily new data. I think we've gotten past the education point now, and people are a little bit more comfortable in saying, okay, let's do a data match. Let's figure out a way to sync the data in an anonymous kind of blind fashion where we can go out and target the users that are truly the consumers of a particular brand. I think what you'll also see is a lot of partnerships evolve leading up into the upfront where you have digital tech companies that have focused on smart TV viewership and have been able to create device graphs that allow them to then understand the household across all the devices. The presentation before was talking about five devices that has multiplied out to I don't remember exactly how many now, in a household. Well, how do we tie those all back to the TV viewership? And now we start to really build a true picture of media consumption at a household and bring real results back to the clients.
As agencies, Carl, Erica?
Yeah, I mean, we all know it is all moving in an audience direction, and data is at the heart of that. I mean, that's why we're all here today. And it's not new. We've been practicing this for decades. I mean, my background's all direct marketing. We talk about audiences like it's a new thing. We always reached audiences at scale using data. What's different today is the plethora of data we have access to and the technology that's allowing us to access the data and to be smart about the data. So it's all about how you use the data and the data intelligence, not necessarily the access to it. And that's where we've got to get sharper and smarter around, is how do we leverage and use the data. And it's not just for that single addressability. It's about using the information and the data that we have to move somebody through a brand's purchase decision. So it's not about that one-time reach and say we've done our job. It's about how do we use the information to drive subsequent contacts with those audiences and using the content and the platforms as a mechanism to express that brand's purchase decision. And that's where we're moving much more, guided by the infinite amount of data and the intelligence we can get from it, first party, third party, second party, so that we can not only be more precise, but we can also move someone through the purchase decision.
Thank you. Erica, what's your perspective on the data? Are you getting what you need?
Yes and no. I think to Denise's point, the first party data and the data that our advertisers are starting to bring to the table has really materialized in the past year. And surprisingly, it's come from the CPGs of the world, mm-hmm. where you literally could say, wait a second, you're selling confectionery. It melts on transport, so you don't really have a digital play. But companies like the Hershey's of the world are thinking very seriously about their data and their ownership of that. And that's complemented, obviously, with the financial services industries and the other players that you would anticipate would have bigger, richer data sets. But they're only just getting their houses in order in that sense, and they're really looking for guidance and our thoughts on how they could best leverage that and how they could bring it to the table. I think the easiest translation point for that really comes into the one-to-one or one-to-household, and that's the clear point, is this the one-to-household device idea graphs are certainly helping us to get a much richer understanding of are we really actually getting into the households and on the right devices and hitting the right consumers. So addressability is the easiest translation. We've used data sets in our advanced TV practice for a number of years. David talked about our AMP data sets, which enable us to to find those content areas and those consumption patterns that pop that wouldn't normally pop. And to say, if we're looking for those harder to reach audiences or those light TV viewers, how can we use the data segments that we have and then go and then use that data to then inform the way that we're planning and purchasing TV? But I think we're still at a very nascent stage. It's great to hear a lot of the what we would call traditional players now really getting very serious about their data houses. Folks on this panel, for example, but I think the standard currency for transaction goes back into the standard. I'm looking for 18 to 34, males. If you're in a CPG type of category, and it's how do we start to get the industry across the board to think differently, not only about the planning but also the measurement of where consumers are taking in content, irrespective of channel, which is how we all think about things.
Right. And just following up, thank you, in terms of David's comment on the business or the infrastructure, data's expensive, right? So both as a media outlet, you have to invest to get good data, and as agencies and the clients, you have to invest. So how does that correlate in terms of capturing either rate increases or premium pricing when you have wonderful content that you can overlay with great data? Is that something as an agency, of course, you'll pay for? It's a given?
Yes, if the data is actionable, if it provides us with the type of signals information that we can be more addressable and therefore see more response, more positive response. So it has to be a correlation, the price and the use of the data with the outcomes, the outputs we're seeing. Data for data's sake doesn't do anything. So it's about, as you said, the closed loop behind the data to be able to use the data not only to pinpoint with more accuracy your audiences, but also measure it on the back end of the outcomes. And if we see that positive outcomes, then yes, then it's worth paying for the data.
Yeah, I mean, Peter, what's interesting, you used the word premium in your question, and Carl, you stayed away from it in your answer. I mean, to me, when you talk about rates, I think that's a really smart way to talk about it. Is it actionable? Is it measurable? Is the client taking more action? I mean, to me, if you want targeted inventory, it should have a targeted CPM. And there's no word premium in there. It's like, no, targeted inventory with results.
I don't even enjoys
a targeted CPM.
Word.
Yeah.
I never use or think of that word premium.
Okay. Erica, what about from your perspective?
I think it goes on to that, how do we transition from thinking about demography for planning and buying to thinking about audiences? I think the necessity of data is there, right, for anything that we do. The minute the client sees a higher CPM, it's like, well, hang on a second, I can still get my cheap reach by doing it this traditional means. And if we are able to prove it out and close the loop, and the easiest way to prove it out and close the loop is really on addressability, especially when you're doing your first-party data matches, then it becomes self-fulfilling and the clients are willing. For example, if you're in automotive and you leverage CRM and you do it really cleverly, you're able to actually move vehicles off the lot. I think it becomes a little bit more cumbersome when you have mixed media models and those planning models that clients are used to that says, this is how I'm going to get my payoff, and it's often about that most cheaper, efficient reach, and it's getting to that education point. I think, yes, targeted CPM is a better analogy than anything else, but again, there's only a certain amount of budget, and there's this, let's go back to the way that we think is always going to work, and getting people over that hurdle, I think, is still a lot of work to be done.
So, Jason, did you have? Okay, so when I think about the data as an integral part of the content when you're in the upfronts, there's a certain amount not only of the investment in the resources to be able to correlate those two together, there's automation and there's technology overlays or even underlying premises that you need that, which leads to the term programmatic that everybody kind of cringes with. Can you foresee a time where the upfronts are conducted in a programmatic fashion so you can have machine to machine talking about, here's the audience, here's the data, here's the great content, here's when it's going to be aired, here's the price, go ahead and buy it? Anybody?
Yeah. I mean, to me,
Peter?
a lot of people say, you know, are the upfronts going to become outdated someday? And you're asking, is programmatic going to replace? And I think the answer is no, because the upfronts to me are about establishing preferred partnerships. And preferred partnerships are more than just transactional. Now, we can agree on rates, and then the machines can target and do all that stuff. But the preferred partnerships also come with terms and conditions about new products and services, exclusivities, first looks. You know, there's many big holding companies who want a first look at some of our things. Like, we're not going to give, by definition, we can't give everybody a first look. You know, preferred partnerships are what the upfront's all about to me. And part of that relationship is an established rate card with terms and conditions, but it goes beyond that. So I don't think a machine is going to replace that element of the upfront.
I also don't think it can replace the content, right? So the upfront is so much about the premium content that is available. And data is fantastic, but there's still value to having those targeted audiences in the right environment, right? And there's always going to be an art to the science. And the upfront is really when all of that premium content comes to bear and we're showing our new shows. Just going in through, you know, an automated fashion and isolating an audience doesn't tell you enough about where that audience is going to be.
I was going to say, I think we have to separate the upfront into two parts. One is, as you said, is understanding what content is out there, what technology is being leveraged and used. It's really a chance for us in the community to understand where things are moving. So it's an important, really important event for us to understand how the networks, how the cable operators, OTT are all moving together. Then there's the transactional part. The transactional part, I also don't believe is going to be fully programmatic, because there is a lot that has to happen in a dialogue, in a discussion. Down the chain, food chain, yes, parts of it might be able to move programmatically, not necessarily the upfront, but the overall buying piece of it. But the upfront as itself is an important way for us in the community to understand where things are moving and to engage in that dialogue, which you really need to have. It can't be all machine.
It's a relationship business, right? It always has been, and it always will remain that way. My core area of responsibility right now is in digital, which is vastly more automated than linear, and yet we still have to maintain relationships because you're battling, a lot of the viewers are crossing multiple channels or multiple content arenas. So you're still battling against one another, against NBC and Hulu, to try and secure larger budgets or more strategic budgets. So I don't think the upfront or the concept of relationships is ever going to go away. You may evolve in terms of how you're speaking at the upfronts or how you're speaking to the different agencies and things like that and pitches and stuff, but it's always going to come down to people negotiating the actual transaction, whether or not we get to a point where computers are pushing the spots out and whatnot. I think time will tell. I think there's a lot of consideration around compliance and so on and so forth that I don't know TV is yet ready to kind of adopt the automated process without having human interaction to say that spot is correct, that can go, that is, you know, with the approved rating and so on and so forth, whereas we've gotten away with it a little bit more in digital. So I think relationships will always fuel the need to have kind of an upfront type of environment.
Because it is humans making the decisions, right, based on those relationships or those interactions.
For now.
Or not. And then the programmatic side, to me, is more about how can you streamline some of the heavy lifting that occurs.
Correct.
And we mentioned a little bit about the evolvement of the upfronts. You know, years ago, it was just what's happening in the major networks, and here's the content of the program. Now, it's what I see is it's not only what's happening with the content, it's where this content is being consumed or viewed across devices. So when you think about, as media outlets, this year's upfronts, what's different from years past, or how much more emphasis are you placing on where that great content is being viewed, or how it's being viewed? Denise?
I think there's a tremendous amount of concern around where the advertisements are placed. I think if you look at the past year and some of the terminology that has dominated the news, whether it's fake news, whether it's some of the measurement and mishaps that have happened across some of the different channels, I think you really can't be too careful when you're considering what, first of all, what channel, and then second of all, what is the content that is adjacent to your brand messaging. So it's very important to us, and that's a continuous dialogue that we continue to have with our clients.
I mean, I feel like this year we're going to see a big change in the ad model in a couple places. When you're talking about where people are watching and how we're counting, I mean, you know, you saw last week at the Coalition for Innovative Media Measurement, CIM,
yes.
On stage there, the Group M guys, thank you, I almost didn't pull that out. So at the CIM conference, the Group M guys were talking about their desire to lead the market on new currency. And I, reading between the lines, it still feels like that currency is going to be about L3, L7, C3, C7, right? And it's still about when are we going to count it and how are we going to count it. And it feels like that conversation is an older conversation in a world where IPTV, you know, one-to-one targeting is absolutely on the rise. I wish we could hopscotch right over this old argument of when are we going to count everybody. The other thing that's likely to change in is the ad model itself. And look to last week's announcement from YouTube saying that they're going to phase out unskippable 30-second spots. So what's going to replace it? Maybe unskippable 20-second spots. So. That'll be a change of form. So change of measurement and a change of creativity, I think, will be big themes. And those are two big signs of the times from those companies.
You'll continue to see the battle between digital pure play and kind of your portals against the TV content, right? And when I say TV content, I'm talking truly to premium content, not necessarily viewed on the linear, on the live TV, because I think what we also need to continue to push forward on, and I like Peter's point about we seem to be stuck in this weird space where we want total measurement across all platforms for A&E networks, but Nielsen hasn't gotten us there. Comscore, Rentrak hasn't gotten us there in a way where we're actually all comfortable and confident that we can move forward, especially across large-scale budgets. So we seem to be in this odd purgatory, and we've been there for quite a while. I don't know that we can jump to, especially at a cable network like A&E, we can't jump to just the one-to-one or the more kind of direct measurement because we still rely so heavily on live TV or that C3 window. So it seems to be kind of an odd space still. We'll continue to push that. Look, our content is actually being consumed more now than it has ever in the past. It's just that it's in all these other platforms. So the message to the agencies and the brands is continue to spread your buyout cross-platform. How do we measure it? How do we judge currency? So on and so forth. We'll have to get to that point. But I think if we're not targeting the users in every possible fashion, then we're missing that incremental reach at some point.
So in short, thank you, Jens. I think when you think about trying to capture those viewers across device, it takes a certain skill set to understand not only the measurement, whether it's Nielsen or whomever, and does a good or an okay job with it, but as agency planners and buyers, that's an expanded skill set, means you've got to either go wider or deeper in terms of training and development to ensure on behalf of your clients you fully understand what's evolving in the marketplace and then how to transact on it. And similarly from the media side, if I'm purporting I got this great content and it's occurring on all these devices, I better understand exactly what that means from a player size to the audience measurement to the uniqueness of the timeliness of when it's airing and such. What do you guys do, especially on the agency side first, in terms of staffing or training or redeploying resources to be atop or ahead of those types of dynamics?
I think that it's not your father's old media buyer, that's for sure. So it's definitely evolving, which is good. It's exciting. You know, change is good. So I believe that you need to bring lots of different skill set. It's not people as much as skill set in it. So people who have a digital understanding, analytics is a big part of it. Because we're not just counting audiences, we're understanding the impact that certain audiences and certain devices make. Because again, it's all about the outcomes. It's not about just the push. It's about what do we drive from all of this. So having all of that data and analytics together to understand how you are evaluating a media buy, not just from the front end audience side, which is critical. So you need people who understand audiences, understand how to build those audiences, understand across device. But also what's important is to look at it from the performance side and the back end. And I would love to see, beyond just counting audiences, what is the efficacy of certain audiences on brand performance, on raising consideration and driving a purchase, doing much more of a closed loop. So the buyers of today and of the future do need a multiplicity of skills. And it's not just one, it's bringing in talent from many different areas of a company, from a analytics side, from a digital side, research all together to kind of build what is going to be the future of what buying audiences is. Because it's not about just how do we procure them, it's also going to be about how we effectively understand how they perform.
And do you think some of that responsibility lies on the media folks to train you? If they're going to tout, my great content is airing across these multiple devices with multiple audience type measurements.
Well, we need to understand from each of the content source providers what they can enable. So can they measure in a closed loop basis their audience? And that's where things are definitely moving. So it's definitely a partnership because we all have to solve this together.
Right. Erica, what about from your side and your team? Training,
I think there's
development?
Two things. So just on that last point, you know, I think our heritage as a business really comes from the digital side. It's, you know, the richness of trying to understand the platforms and the digital ecosystem and how we can navigate through the noise, but also navigate through some of the smoke and mirrors that still exists within the space and applying that to the TV ecosystem. So there's lots of, I think everybody has quite a lot of aspiration, and I think we're all forward-thinking individuals. And when we go and we stand and say, these are the things that we could do, when you start to unpack it, how are we all going to be able to enable that? So I think there's an inflection point where we all need to come to the table and say, what is feasible today? What is measurable today? What is actionable from a data perspective today? And how do we just make sure that we manage all those expectations and keep ourselves honest? Because I think we all want it to be here, but we're still in our early stages. And I think that's important because we work with agency partners all the time. That's part of our day job is just to help our agencies and for them to help us on what the clients really are looking for and to level set on how we're going to actually be able to deliver. On the talent perspective as well as the knowledge gaps, I think we're at that same inflection point that we were at with digital on programmatic several years ago. Now we're seeing that on the TV ecosystem. There's this instance that always goes on within agency holding groups where it's we have to go and get everybody trained up on digital, or we have to go and get all those traditional folks trained up on programmatic. But there hasn't been that two-way conversation, and I think that's what we're finding is most useful is when we partner the folks who are sitting in the agencies who have that rich heritage and understanding of traditional planning and buying models with my folks who come from the digital native programmatic perspective, who know the new ways of planning and trading as well as the new ways of measurement. And it's bringing those two things, those two folks together and those skill sets where we find the biggest benefit. The days of us just being the specialist unit, being the ones who are always brought in and being the mouthpiece isn't enough for clients anymore. What we hear from our clients all the time is, I need my agency teams, not just the specialists, to be fluent in what you guys are talking about. And that's really where we're focusing a lot of our energies is on that cross-pollination and that partnership between the two teams. It could be in the form of champions. It could be in the form of bespoke training sessions that are really speaking to that. And I think that's really where we're going to be able to see the biggest impact on how we continue to ride the evolution of what's going on in this space.
A lot of Carl and Erica's comments about talent are affecting the media side as well. Right, and we're trying to find ways to attract talent into the companies and to get people trained, whether it's cross-platform, whether it's based on data analytics and tech and being able to speak to some of these strategies and whatnot. And it's ever more difficult as you we're talking about battling for viewership against some of these technology companies and the portals and the big social networks and stuff. The same thing's happening in the talent acquisition space as well, where they're able to attract a great deal of the younger talent that's coming out of school, fresh thinkers, and open to the idea of change, but also involved in the technology and understanding how it works a little bit more. They want to go work at some of these other technology companies because it seems a lot cooler on LinkedIn to put that name than the old media brand. So it's a challenge, but it's something that we're aggressively pursuing because it's definitely a necessary component. And if we wait two more years, you're already going to be behind the eight ball. You've got to be ramping up and almost ready to run now, even though we're still kind of in that crawl walk stage.
So if you think about that talent pool and them coming in and you nurturing that talent to grow, it's because of the change in the viewership. And it's just to make sure that you're in line or in tune with what's happening in the way that your media is being consumed. When I think about the upfronts, and again, that episodic event that's going to occur over the next 30 days or so, in addition to promoting it through that actual event, there are a number of social media or cross-platform opportunities that are somewhat non-traditional than what we may have seen in years past. What are your plans or expectations for this year and going forward? Is there going to be a change in the mix from the tune-ins to Hey's the New Great Show to see it highlighted more in social media?
So I know for A&E Networks, going back to the data play, we've used our data that we're leveraging for the sales efforts and to attract brands and advertisers to stay within our content. We're using some of those same data sets and pools on the marketing side to maintain viewership and attract new viewership, but we're doing it in a way that you kind of touched on, which is through social networks and through through channels that are different than the old 30-second spot on TV. What has been difficult is that same pool of viewers that we're looking to attract is very quick to point out, that's an ad. You're just trying to get me to watch, I'm not going to watch. So it almost has to seem organic, and you need to actually have a relationship with these people to get them comfortable with the brand, get them interested in the content, whatever it may be, and that's how you're gonna attract them to come back. So kind of the old days of retargeting and just continuing to pound somebody with a message for 30 days straight on every single display ad that they ever saw, I think it's kind of gone by the wayside, and now you're into these alternative channels that it's an odd space that we're in where our competitors are our partners and our partners are trying to chase the same dollars that we are. So it's an interesting kind of evolution across both TV and digital as they merge together. But we're very much using alternative marketing tactics to try and attract viewership and maintain viewership.
Yeah, I mean, I think that at the heart of the question you said, is the upfront the singular event and how else are you amplifying it? I mean, to me, the upfront has become, just like programming has become a 52-week exercise, we have broadcast upfronts and calendar upfronts. For every holding company, I've got an invitation to come in and give a preview of the upfront. For everybody who doesn't come to the upfront on May 3rd at 9:30 at MSG, let me know if you want to be there. For everybody who doesn't come to that, we film the event and then we take it on the road and do lunch and learn. So to me, it's constant talking about the upfront marketplace where we actually transact. The show itself is one thing, but the selling and the positioning and the persuading and the cajoling happens all the time, including right now.
You heard it first. The rule kickstarts the upfronts today. Denise, any thoughts there?
Sure. So you asked about social and are we using social as a mechanism to help promote the upfront? We're always using social. You know, we recognize that viewership patterns have changed and our viewers have evolved to use multiple different channels. So we're very active in our partnerships, whether it's with BuzzFeed or Vox, most recently with Apple News. And then, you know, we do have our Social Sync product, which allows us to have our brands put their brand messaging out through 900 million touch points, excuse me, across the major social channels. So, you know, we're doing it for the upfront, but we do it all year long. If if you've seen a lot of people were recently using the This Is Us frames around their Facebook pictures and all of that. So to your point, it's, you know, you have the upfront show and the event, but then these social activities are happening all year round.
You know, and from a marketing and advertising, I like to see the social media because it's, you know, we're part of the audience as well.
Part of the viewing audience or the buying audience?
The buying audience. So seeing it in the context of social media and what people are saying really reinforces a lot of the content. So it works on both ends.
Great. So I do want to leave some time for questions from the audience, but I have one. Come June, all the trades, all the newspapers are covering the upfronts, which they will from the start all the way through to the end. There'll be headlines about rate increases being flat or decreasing. Any predictions related to, will you look to pay more, pay less, pay the
We're
same?
Never looking to pay more. So that's, it's going to be an interesting year. I believe it's going to be flat. I mean, last year we saw an increase. As we know, and we talked about, and David mentioned this morning, audiences are continuing to fragment. So we're going to need to really substantiate the cost because of that fragmentation. So I don't believe we're going to see an uptick. I think it'll be flat and continually challenged year over year because of that fragmentation. And how are we justifying the cost over multiple devices? It can't be just a single device anymore.
I predict that companies that have scarcity will enjoy increases in volume and CPM. And
sorry, just so we're clear, when you say scarcity, are we talking about in volume of viewers or avails because the content is so hot? How do you describe it?
Sure. I mean, if it's scarcity of rating points, if it's scarcity of the right reach, I mean, not all reach is created equal.
Right.
Not all impressions are created equal. If you have great product, I think the upfront will be a happy time as a publisher. And you know, we anticipate that demand is outstripping supply at our place, so we're going to try and strike the best deals on behalf of the marketer to grow our business as well.
Erica, what's your expectation on behalf of your clients? Can you comment?
David is a much better source for what we think was going to actually happen on the upfronts, and I wouldn't want to tread on those toes. But I do think that specific to what we do in the advanced TV space and specific to what we do in addressability, it's all about that premium, to your point already, Peter, and thinking about the value, right? And I think a different way or a different currency for exchanging things should be on the value or the payoff that we get. And to me, that's what's most important in this upfront is seeing the right inventory that's going to spark what we need in terms of finding those harder to find audiences and to prove the efficacy out of planning in a different way.
Jason, any thoughts?
I can't speak to increases, decreases, et cetera, but I think what we'll see continue to kind of shake out, to Peter's point, is fair market value based on audiences. So what's the target? What are you looking for? Are you looking for the Viceland audience, which is a very hard to reach male younger skewing demo that isn't necessarily watching TV across multiple channels or multiple airing spots? Then that might bring a different story than some of the larger tentpole type events.
Right. Denise, I saved for last.
Price increases or decreases, but as our CEO expressed on our last earnings call, we're expecting a strong upfront.
That's great. Thank you. So we have a couple of minutes left. We'll open it up to questions for this esteemed panel here. Anybody? We got one in the back there. I think there's a microphone right behind you. You can tell us who you are, where you're from, and then the question.
Yeah. Josh Dreller, 4C. Sir, you mentioned about closed-loop reporting. I'm a digital guy, so I'm just now getting into TV for about a year, and I also believe in closed-loop reporting. My question to you is, being a digital guy, what can I bring to clients that is enough, that isn't exactly down to the penny of sales, more than just audience delivery, but not getting down to the very last penny of what the ROI is, or is that the ultimate standard?
Well, that's the ultimate. So the question is what to measure in that closed loop, and obviously, sales is the ultimate, but if we could get to even a point where we know we're driving retail traffic or that we are driving online traffic to it, but we need to have some measure of effectiveness beyond just the audience reach. So ideally, it would be closed loop in terms of sales, and there are ways to do that, But we've got to close the circle more than just from an audience reach perspective. Well, I mean, obviously consideration, but that's a lot softer. The further down you can go to an actual sale, to a transaction, is where we should be pushing for.
Thank you. Any others? I see a hand back there.
Hi. Daniel Darling from Programmatic. I was curious, in sort of this very relationship-focused buying and selling process, what parts pre-execution do you think can still be automated? What of the heavy lifting can we still get out of the heavy lifting bucket?
On the sales or buy side, which, or both? From the buy side perspective, certainly automating or understanding the audiences and what they deliver from a program side, cross-program, cross-device, anything we can have more at our desktop, more at our disposal to understand that would help us greatly in the buy process. It doesn't necessarily mean that there's a buy button attached to it, but having more access to on the desktop about audiences will help us, even if the transaction is done in partnership in person. It doesn't mean that the buy part of it has to go all the way through, but the more we have access to understanding those audiences cross-platform, the better it is for us because we'll be more efficient in the whole planning process.
Sure, I think to your point, it has to do with target segment selection. And then also, if you look at our programmatic television products, we also facilitate the selection of inventory and the transmission of plans programmatically. So I think, you know, the relationship side is very important, but we're all for looking at efficiencies and ways that we can drive that through the programmatic products that we offer.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. And everybody, thank you for your time and interest, and especially thank you guys for participating.